Well, to all the attendees here, thank you for coming. And thank you to Hadi and Sushia for agreeing to talk tonight. For any first timers at this event is called Science on Tap, and it's run by a group at Penn State called the Science Policy Society. And we are a student organization that operates at the intersection of science and policy. So in general, our membership consists of grad students working in some area of STEM. So we have people from geology, climate sciences, food science, physics, material science, pretty much everywhere. And we do all sorts of programming related to policy. So we'll do policy writing, and we'll do events like this to help communicate science between people in research and the general public. So actually Science on Tap is probably our most popular outreach event. We host this event about once a month, and we try to feature scientists from a wide range of backgrounds to talk about their research in a way that is accessible to the general public. So people who don't necessarily have a technical background. And we've been doing these events for a few years now. They've been very successful. We've had people talk about gravitational waves, climate change, human sexuality, insects, hurricanes, anthropology of alcohol, and a lot of others. This event used to be held in a tap house downtown, but obviously because of the pandemic, we've had to move this virtual. But because this was originally meant to be held at a bar, please feel free to enjoy an alcoholic beverage of your choice. So at this point, I want to go ahead and introduce the two speakers we have this evening. So first, we're going to have Dr. Hadi Padmanabhan, who recently finished his PhD at Penn State in material science and engineering, and he just started a postdoc at Harvard, and his research is more in the physics of materials, and he is particularly concerned with magnetism in materials. And then we have Dr. Sushia Rahimizadeh, who finished his PhD a few years ago at the University of Colorado at Boulder in electrical engineering. And now he has joined a team at the NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory, where he's been doing some cutting edge work in engineering microwave technologies for deep space spacecraft. And these two do work that's very different from each other, but I thought it would be an interesting pair because their research overlaps only in the common use of some form of electromagnetism to study what they study. Just about in any area of science, we use some region of the electromagnetic spectrum to do research. And so I thought by pairing these two together, we could highlight some really interesting ways scientists do this. So at this point, I'd like to hand it over to Hadi to get us started.
Hi. Okay, thank you. I want to say, first of all, that I'm really happy to be doing this. I remember attending some of these events in grad school when they happened in bars. It was obviously more fun that way, but I have a drink. I think Angela and Sushia do as well. So I hope you enjoy this. Let me pull up my presentation. All right, can you see it and can you hear me well? Yes, okay. So today I'm gonna talk about using light to study matter. I'm gonna start this talk with a quiz of sorts. I'm just gonna flash some images at you, and I'd like you to tell me what you think they are, what they might be coming from. So let's start with this one. If you're shy, just throw something in the chat. I see something in there. Stars, yeah. So Arshia says these are stars. That is correct. Constellations, yeah. So this is actually a drawing of a bunch of stars by Johannes Kepler. Actually, this was when he discovered a supernova for the first time. Actually, no, this was not the first time. It was the second time, actually. But this was a supernova that was 20,000 light years away. And he saw it with the naked eye. No cameras back then. So he just drew a picture of the sky, beautiful picture, and it was in this book. And he's actually marked the supernova with an N. Okay, next image. Any guesses? The Earth? Nope, it's not the Earth. Plant cells, yeah. These are actually plant cells. And I believe this was the first image of, or the first time plant cells were discovered by Robert Hooke using a microscope. So this is from, I believe, a pine branch. And these are the plant cells. Okay, let's do another one. Black hole, I like that. We're in the right domain, I would say. This is a tough one. It's if you know, you know, as the kids say. star photo. Okay, so this is something like that. So this is actually an image of the Andromeda galaxy. Captured by Edwin Hubble using a 100-inch telescope. It's actually just a plate on which you collect light from this galaxy, and you this is what it looks like. We've obviously come a long way since this, but this was the first image of a galaxy outside of our own, outside of the Milky Way. Okay, last one, I promise. This is the last one. Not as pretty as the others, but I think possibly more significant. I don't know. Yeah, these are frequency bands. Braggs. Yeah. I see a lot of scientists here. So this is actually the Bomber spectrum of hydrogen by Hertzberg. So this is just light from a hydrogen lamp dispersed using a prism. So you get all these different lines. And it was experimental data like this that was the foundation of quantum theory, which developed simultaneously with all of these experimental discoveries. The reason I showed you all of this is that all of these are examples of how we used light to study the universe, whether it was this massive 100-inch telescope used by Hubble, or literally the naked eye, as in the case of Kepler. It is our ability to see, manipulate, detect light that allowed us all of these insights into the universe. And today I will be talking about a universe of a different kind, and that is the world of materials. So you can take any old piece of rock, and if you look deep enough, you find that it's home to this rich landscape of atoms in this highly periodic crystal lattice, surrounded by electrons and in highly correlated quantum states. And spins, which are properties of electrons, which give rise to what we know as magnetism. As you can imagine, all of these are extremely small. There's nothing that you can actually see with the eye or even sometimes a microscope. Nevertheless, light allows us to see and study this invisible world. And that's what I am going to try to explain today. It's useful to start with what light is. We all see light all around us, but that is only a small part of the vast spectrum of light, or it's something we should actually call electromagnetic radiation. So we see sunlight, but microwaves used to heat food. This is also light. X-rays also light. Radio waves also light, or I should say electromagnetic radiation. The only difference between all of these different kinds of radiation is that they have different wavelengths. So you can see that radio waves are huge. They can be hundreds of meters long. X-rays are tiny, the size of an atom. And along with the change in wavelength, because these are waves, they carry different frequencies, which correspond to different energies. And this is actually what makes light such a powerful tool in studying anything, really, but in particular studying materials. It's because a lot of phenomena in materials happen in this within this spectrum. So for example, interatomic vibrations happen in the infrared region of the spectrum. At the distance between atoms and solids are right here in this 10 to the minus 10 meters in this range of wavelengths. Electronic energies basically span the entire electromagnetic spectrum, and magnetic dynamics, for instance, also happen in the infrared, but they span this really wide range of energies. And it's this infinite versatility of light that allows us to probe all of these different phenomena just by choosing the kind of light we want to study the material with. And because light is a wave, you can mix these waves together, you can manipulate them. It really is a powerful tool to study materials. So before getting into materials, I want to start with something closer to home. So this is, for some reason, a picture of a park. Again, for some reason, LeBron James decides to go to the park, shoot some hoops with his daughter, possibly. So what does LeBron see? So behind the scenes, what's happening here is you have light coming from somewhere. In this case, it's the sun, right? Which is the light source, and it illuminates everything. This light is reflected off of all of these different objects, but it's not simply reflected. These objects manipulate the light. They absorb some colors, they reflect some colors, they change the intensity of the incident light. And then LeBron James detects this transmitted light with his eyes. His eyes are able to distinguish the different colors that are part of this light, and also the intensity of different colors. For instance, here he might see mostly green, right? And finally, by processing all of his information, he's able to construct an image of the world, and then make a perfect behind the back pass to his daughter, because that's what LeBron James does. But going back to light, the reason I tell you all of this is because this is exactly what happens in the experiments we do to use light to study materials. This is a class of experiments broadly called spectroscopy, optical spectroscopy. I really want to emphasize that what's happening in these experiments is identical in some ways to how we see the world. We have a source, this could be a laser or some other light source, which is incident on the material. This could be a crystal, it could be a solution, it could be a rock, a biological sample. The material then interacts with the light, and as in the world around us, it might change colors, it might reflect, absorb different colors, and all of this transmitted light is collected by some means. In this case, it's collected onto what's called a diffraction grating. And the purpose of a grating is simply to split the incident light into all its constituent colors. And this is, again, what happens in our eye. And finally, using some kind of camera, we detect the different colors, the intensities of the different colors. In this way, we get information about this material and its interaction with the light. One of the main differences here is that we are sensitive to not just visible light, but also invisible light. So UV radiation, IR radiation, X-rays, and so on. And of course, because these are machines, these can be extremely sensitive to both changes in intensity and the color. And it's this information that encodes information about the material itself, properties of the material. And finally, we can transform the material as we do these studies, right? See how the signal we measure changes as you change the material itself. And this is actually what we did as part of my thesis at Penn State. My work happened in the Millennium Science Complex. Some of you may know of it. And I'll tell you a little bit about what we did. So we use light specifically to study atomic vibrations in solids. So you can, these vibrations happen in all solids, but we consider this specific layered magnetic material, just a magnet, but it happens to have this atomic, atomically layered structure, as you can see here. As it turns out, atomic vibrations change the color of light when they interact with light, right? So what that means is depending on the type of vibration, so there's all these different different patterns of vibrations you can have in this crystal, depending on the type of vibration and the frequency of the vibration, it can change the color of the light that it reflects. And how much it changes the color depends on the frequency of the vibration, and how strong the intensity is depends on the amplitude of the vibration, right? So we studied this material. We identified all of these different peaks in the spectrum corresponding to these different vibrations. And then what we did was we put the whole thing into, we cooled it down to really low temperatures, and we put it into a magnet, right? And we applied a magnetic field. The reason for that is we wanted to change the material as we studied these signals about the that gave us information on the atomic vibrations. Applying a magnetic field changes the magnetic structure. So we went from this alternating magnetic structure to a zigzag structure, finally to this fully aligned magnetic structure, which is basically just like a fridge magnet at this point. What was really surprising is that even though atomic vibrations have in principle nothing to do with the magnetic structure, we found that when we measured the intensity of these vibrations, they actually changed with the magnetic structure. And we could see this for two different types of vibrational modes. And what's more, we also found that these vibrations, the change in amplitude exactly tracks the change in magnetism. And this allowed us to come to the conclusion that in this material, atomic vibrations are strongly intertwined with magnetism. And I want to say that all of this, all of these insights we got purely by looking at how these vibrations change the color of light. So in that sense, it's a very simple experiment, but it allows us to see part of the rich physics that lives inside all of these different materials. I know we're going to have questions later on, but I want to pause here to see if there's anything that anyone wants to ask me right away. If not, I'll just move on. So I'll give it a few seconds.
I have a question.
Hi, Sushia. Yeah.
What is the implication for atomic vibrations being intertwined with magnetism? For that.
Yeah, I'm glad you asked me this. So this is the first step towards being able to control magnetism in a material like this. If you know that atomic vibrations are connected to magnetism by turning on atomic vibrations in some way or distorting the atomic lattice in some way, you can in turn change the magnetic properties. And changing magnetic properties in these different ways can have quite cool applications in various devices, for example, memory storage and so on. So this is really the first fundamental step towards being able to do that. All right. I'm going to move on for now. So far I've told you about using light to study study materials, and in fact throughout history we have used light to see the world, to make sense of it. But what if we wanted to go beyond that? What if we wanted to use light to control matter, right? Have light not just play a passive role, but an active role, and actually transform materials using light. You talk about materials, they're a lot like other things that we are surrounded by. For instance, everything around us is lives at equilibrium, right? You can think of a glass of water, you can shake it how much ever you want, right? However you want, and it will eventually settle into this equilibrium state. A rock sliding down a hill, you know, classical example, it will eventually stop when it reaches its valley, right? And it is the same thing with materials. All the materials around us live at equilibrium. This is a schematic of an energy landscape of sorts, and everything around us lives right here in this valley. But what that also means is that there is this unexplored landscape of material states that is completely unknown and inaccessible in some sense, because we're not able to drive this thing away from equilibrium. But if we can, it's been shown with experiments over the last decade and theoretical predictions that you can realize all kinds of new properties which are of interest, such as superconductivity, magnetic order, entangled quantum states, and many more that still just haven't been explored. So this is really the problem state, and can we achieve this with light, right? The thing to know about materials, though, is this is one of the challenges, that things move really fast at the atomic scale. You look at how fast things change in the macroscopic world, for instance, water on the surface of the sea. You think of ice melting, happens over a time scale of seconds, minutes, right? Or even bigger objects typically change over much longer time scales. At the atomic scale, naturally, things are much smaller, but that also means that any change happens at incredibly fast time scales. For example, atomic vibrations, electronic transitions, these happen over a time scale of femtoseconds. A femtosecond is a thousandth of a trillionth of a second, so it's a really small span of time. And just to put it into context, the ratio between a femtosecond and a second is the same ratio between a second and 30 million years, okay? So this is an extremely small span of time, and things are happening at this time scale. So if you want any kind of control over materials, you need to be able to access these time scales. And that is exactly what light is able to provide, in particular, cutting edge laser sources. So you think of a regular old flashlight, shines light. It's light that is kind of diffuse. It's this continuous wave of energy, right? If you take a laser pointer, these have been around for a while. Obviously, the light is more pointed, in some sense, more focused. It's monochromatic, that is, it's a single color, but it's still this continuous wave of energy. In contrast to this, pulsed lasers actually deliver radiation. They deliver light in these really short pulses. In fact, these pulses can be as short as tens of femtoseconds. In fact, even shorter than 10 femtoseconds. Nothing in between, and then the next pulse, nothing in between, the next pulse, and that's how it goes. What this means for us is that by correctly playing with these pulses, you can actually access the timescales that are intrinsic to materials and atoms, electrons, the timescales at which they change. And that's what's been achieved over the past two decades with these new age light sources. We're actually able to make femtosecond movies to capture the motion of atoms in real materials. For this, we use what's called a pump probe method. Without going into the details, what I can tell you is that by using these pulses of light, we can make snapshots, create snapshots of the material in real time at different points. And by putting these snapshots together, you can make a movie of and capture these atoms in motion in some sense. We did some of this as part of my thesis. So this is actually a video of how atomic vibrations evolve over time, over a time scale of hundreds of femtoseconds. And this completely opens up all of these different possibilities of controlling matter, seeing how they evolve in real time, and potentially achieving states, achieving properties that wouldn't be accessible otherwise at equilibrium. So this is, I believe, my last slide. So I'm going to leave it here. And we'll hear Sushia talk about cool space stuff, which I'm sure is going to be great. I'm going to stop sharing my screen. Sushia.
Thanks, Hari. I don't know how I'm going to top that plot of atomic vibrations, but...
No, I figured the only way I can talk about material science is if I go before the NASA talk. So, just by design.
You had an excellent talk. That was a really dope talk. Do y'all hear that, or is it just my screen?
I don't hear anything.
It's a faint noise, but it's not that loud.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm gonna have to log out and come back.
If anyone has questions in the meantime, they can post them in the Q&A. Mm-hmm. And feel free to post questions throughout the talks in the Q&A, and we'll get to those at the end.
What did Sushia say that he's going to come back?
Yeah, he has to log out and come back. And I think there was maybe there was some feedback on his end. Mm-hmm. Or something.
Aubrey has a question, and that is, what is the amount of time between pulses in the laser? Does the amount of time between pulses matter? It actually does matter. Ideally, in fact, you want the time between pulses to be as long as possible so that you essentially do an experiment with one pulse, and then you don't want the next pulse to mess with your data, right? So you want it to be as long as possible. If the pulses are too close together, you start seeing heating effects, effects you don't want to see, basically. Arshia has a question. Should I answer that now or wait until Sushia is done with his talk, Angela, Anna?
I guess, Sushia, want to first see if you are having the same issue?
No, but it's fixed.
Okay, you can go ahead and then let's go back to the question at the end, just so we have time to get through everything.
Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Sushia. My pronouns are he, him, his. I work at... a branch within NASA called Jet Propulsion Laboratory, where we focus on more of our deep space applications and missions. We're very research focused in our engineering and our science. And we focus a lot on robotics and rovers and probes and satellites that are meant to go past any asset that's meant to go past our moon. And my particular role at NASA is called a technologist, and where I'm a research-oriented engineer, but it's part of my job to be constantly learning about every aspect of science so that I can have conversations with scientists and academia to understand what scientists need in the next 10 years, whether it be for terrestrial applications or for space. And then to spend 5 years at a time exploring technologies that will enable what scientists really need to figure out. And I'll have to preface my talk by saying that because I have a security clearance, I have to get approved everything that I ever present to anyone. And this talk wasn't approved. So I have to suddenly make a new talk. So a lot of it I'll have to talk through, and a lot of it I don't have citations. I'm so sorry. But none of what I'm going to show you is something that I did myself, unless I specifically say it, unless it was published. First, I'll start by explaining how an electromagnetic wave works. And that's this. I feel that I want to do that right away, not only because it makes sense to do that right away so that you understand the rest of the talk, but also I want to communicate that this is the main thing that scientists and engineers in this field do. First, we need to understand exactly and precisely how an electromagnetic wave will behave in the ideal context and in the context of a certain environment. And then we make an observation of that electromagnetic radiation. And the difference between what we expected and what we observed is where we do all that learning of the things that we can't observe otherwise. So the way a normal electromagnetic wave works is that whenever there's an electric field that is varying in time, or that is if it's oscillating, that oscillating electric field will create a magnetic field. And a changing magnetic field will create an electric field, which will make it a magnetic field, which will make an electric field. And so this like piggyback relationship between an electric field and a magnetic field, and how they work together to co-evolve and to propagate together, is how an electromagnetic wave can move across your living room, and or that's also how it moves across the entire universe, is this, in some sense, this perpetual motion between the two. As you can see in the GIF, it's not always as planar as a lot of these diagrams that if you ever looked at electromagnetic wave, you'll see, as in the top right. There's electric fields and magnetic fields really only happen in a three-dimensional sense. And this relationship between electric and magnetic fields is a relationship that we are constantly taking advantage of in order to go to distances to we haven't been able to go before, or to access extremely small spaces, or just in general, just inaccessible spaces. And a lot of times when electromagnetics is presented like this, you see these diagrams like this and it implies that electromagnetics are very unidirectional or planar, but actually it's a very multidimensional phenomenon. And if you look at the bottom right, the analogy between electromagnetics and water often is a very appropriate analogy. So for example, if there's a calm lake and you drop a pebble in it, and you'll see these ripples continuously ripple out from the source of that impact. This is a lot how electromagnetics works, especially with natural things in the universe that are naturally emitting electromagnetic radiation that we want to observe. And if you've ever observed the ripples on a lake, you'll also notice that the ripples are strongest near the source, but then they decay rapidly as you get further away from that source. And that's one of the like thousands of problems that we deal with when we're trying to make an observation of an electromagnetic wave. And that is, number one, it's how do we detect something that's such low power? So for example, if you do the trigonometry, you'll come to the conclusion that the distance away from that source of the radiation and to where you're measuring it is inversely proportional to the distance from it. So for example, if you are 10 meters away from that source, then now the electromagnetic radiation is 1/100th of the power than it was initially radiated at. And now think about it in terms of a galactic scale or just in the scale of our solar system. Hubble is about 500 kilometers away from sea level. And so whenever Hubble wants to tell us something or to give us data or to give us a picture, we receive it at 1/1,000,000,000th of the power that it transmitted it at. And that's a very low power. In fact, that's the thermal radiation from your hand is a louder noise than what we're trying to actually receive. And that's a man-made signal. So imagine you're trying to do some astronomy on something that's in a different galaxy, or you're trying to do something that's on the bottom of the ocean, or you're trying to detect gravitational waves. These are extremely low power signals that are the targets for our instruments or systems. But we have to figure out ways to be able to decipher, to dig that signal out from the noise from the rest of the world. And most natural phenomena happen in this way, in this pebble. But as engineers, we come up with a variety of tricks to help us lessen the reduction of power between where it's coming from and how we're receiving it. And this is basically the objective of an antenna design. So what I'm showing here in the middle is an antenna that actually Angela and I designed during our internship at NASA and Goddard. And the animation you're seeing here is just an electric field around this antenna. This antenna is a helix of copper. And through this antenna design, we were able to get this what's called a radiation pattern. A radiation pattern is a pattern of radiation from a source. And in this case, the source or the observer is an antenna, and we can re-engineer the way, thus to go back to the pebble in the water, for example, we can re-engineer the way that these ripples propagate through the water through electromagnetics, basically. And so in the bottom right is what in our field we call a radiation pattern. But the red dot would be a perfectly natural radiation pattern from a typical source. And then we re-engineer that radiation pattern so that it radiates in the direction of where we know the source is. So in a sense, we're fine-tuning those waves to focus, to have a focus link between the observer and the source, so that we minimize that loss and reduction. And I like this picture on the far left. This is not a measurement that I did, but it is a measurement that we took at work, where it's a similar, you can see that it's the same type of antenna that I've designed here. But here's a case where we can actually visibly observe a 2 GHz signal. Usually a light doesn't become visible until you get into the terahertz range. But here in the vacuum of space, there's nothing to slow electrons down. And so a problem that we often have with our high power instruments, our high power electromagnetics, is that the electrons, without having anything to stop them, like air, they can actually have this avalanche effect where nothing is stopping them. And then they cascade with another electron. These electrons start an avalanche effect with all the other electrons until they eventually start forming plasma in the form of microwave radiation that you can physically see with your with human eyes, because it's so hot that now it's becoming plasma and it's turning into microwave, is transitioning to a more infrared observable state. And that this is often a problem. This is a way that we can sometimes visualize some of our radiation patterns. And here's a pretty cute picture of electromagnetic spectrum from the NASA website. And I like how on the bottom it shows the different frequencies that we use different applications for. And these are largely ways in which humans have figured out how to harness electromagnetic radiation for certain purposes, like heating food and using cell phones and stuff. But one important aspect of how we take advantage of electromagnetics is understanding how they interact with natural phenomena around us. One thing that you can see, first of all, is just how relatively narrow light that we can see is. But we take advantage of that whole spectrum whenever we're trying to understand things that we can't see. And what I want to attempt to try to do in my little talk is to highlight how in each of these different regimes, we use them for very different purposes. So for example, at really low frequencies, like I'm talking kilohertz, which is about the frequency of sound or our voices, very low frequency. There is a relationship between how large the wavelength is and how far into a material that electromagnetic wave can travel. So you may have observed this in real life when you're at a traffic stop next to a car that's playing a lot of rap. You can hear the bass, but you can't hear the treble. That's because that difference in frequency is enough that low frequencies can propagate through your car and even through metal. But even that little difference in 100 kilohertz between bass and treble, it can't propagate through your car. And we actually take advantage of that a lot of the time. So for example, I spoke with a scientist came to me 3 months ago because they're formulating a mission where they need to map how heat moves throughout the interior of Venus. And there's currently no solution to that, right? Like, how do you watch how heat is moving underneath matter, through matter? We can observe heat coming off of matter, but we can't directly observe what's happening beneath the surface of a planet, for example. So the solution we're coming up with is actually doing thermal measurements using low frequency signals. Or for example, submarines use sonic radar or, you know, kilohertz level electromagnetic radiation to do their navigation, because high frequency signals just die in power when they're traveling through anything. So, for example, light can barely go through skin, but it can't really penetrate through other things. So we use lower frequency signals to get through things in space that we can't see otherwise. Here's something that I can show, actually, because we're about to publish it. Here's a chip that I spent the last year designing. And it's a way that, so all of our signals so far, so cell phone signals are around 2 gigahertz, Wi-Fi is around 2 gigahertz, and then there's an entire frequency range where we kind of lose our command of how we can control electromagnetics to a large degree. So there's a lot of engineering that we can't achieve because the wavelength is so small that it's hard to use electronics or semiconductors to manipulate them, because the wavelength is so small that relative to the world of the wavelength, it'd be like if you the scale doesn't scale linearly, but imagine if I'm a 2 gigahertz signal, it's easy for me to walk around to hike a mountain relatively, right? But if you're an ant, it's a much different problem. It's not even more difficult. It's a completely different problem. And so a lot of times we have to think of electromagnetics in terms of what is the world relative to the wavelength. And I'll talk about that more as I talk about some of the applications of some of this stuff that we're doing. For example, NASA is really taking advantage of some of the electromagnetic properties of our actual moon. For example, we have figured out that the soil on the moon actually has electromagnetic properties. In this, they actually have the same properties as we that we use in a lot of our antennas. So there's a huge mission. It's called the Lunar Gateway, where we're establishing a huge gateway on the moon. And a large aspect of that is taking advantage of the electromagnetic radiation, radio electromagnetic properties of the moon itself. So for example, in one of the craters, we're planning to create this giant reflector dish antenna out of the moon itself. Or in the bottom right, you see these little CubeSats, you see these little tiny satellites with lasers going in between them. We are working on, my group is working on a mission where we're using a constellation of small satellites to effectively form a giant planet-wide satellite, a giant planet-wide antenna that's going to be positioned behind the moon to be able to do astronomy beyond our galaxy. And the reason this is the best place in our solar system to do that is because the moon actually acts like a shield from all of the noise coming from the Earth. There's a lot of man-made noise, but there's also a lot of natural noise that we can't get rid of unless we take advantage of some of the celestial geometries of our universe. This is kind of shown here. Our atmosphere interacts with electromagnetics in a variety of different ways. So sometimes that hinders us. So for example, there's a lot of observations that we can't make on Earth that we have to go into space for because our atmosphere is, even our atmosphere has electromagnetic properties to it. It's called the ionosphere. Our ionosphere is electrically charged, and those electrical charges interact with natural and man-made signals in a variety of different ways, which I also want to talk about in a second. But at NASA, we engineer systems across this whole band because we need to work on, we need to use radiation that is dependent on the thing that we're trying to observe. So for example, let me skip to this slide. This is one of my favorite radars ever built. It was built by this Iranian electrical engineer at NASA Goddard, where scientists realized that there's a huge problem in our climate modeling and our climate forecast, and that is the existence of ice clouds. Ice clouds are clouds of ice particles that sometimes we can't see because they're less dense than clouds made of water, and they reflect light. So sometimes we can't see them because they're reflecting light. And they're just notoriously difficult to measure. So the solution that NASA came up with is developing a radar that uses lasers, uses high frequency signals, that where the wavelength is the same, is similar in size to a flake of ice. And that happens to be around 833 gigahertz. So very high frequency, but still before you get into optical engineering and photonics. And the reason that is because, remember my example with being an ant versus being a human on a mountain. We want our electromagnetic signal to be affected by only the science target and nothing else. So for example, you can see in the top left figure, a lot of times they had a lot of difficulty figuring out how to design the system, because if we were to use light would be really good to detect ice clouds, but more optical frequency stuff. But anything higher frequency than 900 gigahertz would get reflected off of water clouds or normal clouds, because light doesn't go through clouds effectively. So they needed a frequency low enough that it could go past certain things in our atmosphere, but not go past ice themselves. And this is a really interesting example of how we, of how this whole principle of making the invisible visible is that we transmit a signal, and then we observe how that signal was distorted and manipulated by the time it got back to us. So in the case of an ice cloud, what that means is you transmit a pulse, and we know that scientists tell us that ice clouds have a huge impact on global temperature, and that that scientists did the math and they figured out that even the orientation, the statistical orientation of these ice particles impacts climate differently. So we needed to be able to understand where are the ice clouds, how dense are they, and even where are the little ice flakes pointing. And so you need a signal low enough in wavelength that it'll reflect, it'll bounce off of an ice flake, and then the direction that it bounces off, the intensity that it reflects and the intensity that it absorbs and how it rotates directly can tell you about the nature of these ice clouds around the world. Another very fascinating one, it was one of those missions that kind of changed the way we think about planets, was a mission by the Chinese Space Agency, where they were the first ones to attempt to use microwave radiation to understand what's happening within the inside of a planet. This is actually not a planet, but a moon. This is our moon. And here is the first high resolution thermal map of anything, including much of our Earth. And the only way they were able to do this was by taking advantage of a concept called black body radiation. And this is radiation that that emanates from anything that has any energy whatsoever. So if electrons are moving, they are radiating something electromagnetic. And normally, whenever you want to look at, when you want to observe or measure heat, you might instantly think of a thermal infrared image, right? And the reason that is, and the reason why majority of our astronomy is where we're trying to observe thermal characteristics of the things around us, is that this black body radiation is emitting across every frequency, almost all huge range of frequencies, but it peaks in the infrared range of frequencies. But the challenge of infrared is that you can't really see beyond a few centimeters, I think, or millimeters. This is problematic when we're trying to understand the evolution of a planet or of a solar system of our galaxy. So we leverage lower frequency signals, microwaves. Microwave frequency is everything from 3 to 300 gigahertz. That way the signals can penetrate out from the core of the planet through the whole of the planet, all the way up to the satellite that was orbiting the moon. And we were able to passively receive what that temperature was just by taking advantage of the fact that we know if there's heat, it's going to be emitted across a wide range of frequencies. And we're going to choose a frequency that allows penetration through a planet, but that is high enough that we're able to actually detect temperatures. There's been such fascinating uses of electromagnetics to understand very fundamental things about even just our solar system, even just our planet. So for example, in the top left was from the Mariner 2 mission. Mariner the Mariner program was like in the 60s, and it was the Mariner 2 was the first man-made anything to reach another orbit of another planet. And they made a very fascinating discovery by accident with the Mariner 2. And that is, well, they expected that once Mariner went to the other side of the planet, that they would instantly lose, whenever they would lose line of sight of the satellite, they expected that we would lose communication link. But actually, they were able to keep communicating with the satellite even as it went almost all the way behind. And it took a while to understand what exactly was happening, because certainly we understand that a 3 gigahertz signal, 8 gigahertz signal can't go through a planet because it's too high frequency. But it led scientists to realize that there's an atmosphere around Venus, and that there's something about that atmosphere that is interacting with electromagnetics. And it turns out later they realized that was an ionosphere, that there's a thin portion of the atmosphere that is electrically charged. And that was actually the first time we realized that Earth has an ionosphere. So we didn't understand that we had an ionosphere, which is also a necessary understanding to realization before understanding that we have an ozone. We didn't realize that until we went to Venus and just observed that our electromagnetic link between the Earth and the satellite actually changed. And so they sent about 8 more mariners after that just to keep studying this phenomenon. And the whole time they're still using electromagnetics, because electromagnetics is really the best way, maybe even the only way, to observe something that you can't actually touch, observe something you can't actually reach, something that you can look at remotely and still learn so much about it. And then a result of this, by the time it got to the late Mariners, was a really good understanding of how not only atmospheres, but also how gravity can affect electromagnetics. This led to I'll finish my talk here in a sec. This is one of my coolest things that I think our division does. And that is measurements of gravity waves using solar system-wide antennas, basically. And so electrogravitational waves, very briefly speaking, are formed when there's something violent happening in our universe enough that it creates ripples. They have ripples in time and space. I don't know. I don't understand that field of physics as much. But we do understand enough the frequency at which these gravitational waves happen. And on the bottom right is a picture of LIGO, which is a very famous facility that is able to measure gravitational waves, but only to a certain wavelength, so only to a certain frequency. If I recall, it's about on the order of hertz, 10 hertz maybe. So it can pick up on gravitational waves that are on the order of single digit hertz, maybe double digit hertz. But there are a huge range of gravitational waves that are really interesting for scientists to understand. For example, gravitational waves are still emanating from the Big Bang. And these gravitational waves are theorized to be at about microhertz level. And so LIGO isn't able to detect that. So what JPL did with Cassini, which was the satellite that went to Saturn, we knew the limitation of LIGO is that it's only a couple miles long. But the wavelength at microhertz, I don't know, I didn't do the math, but it's huge. It's maybe bigger than our planet. And so you need an antenna that's proportional to the wavelength in order for it to function properly. And so they actually formed an antenna by the electromagnetic link between Los Angeles and Saturn. And so that was that officially was the biggest antenna humans have ever made. And last I heard, we recently were able to detect gravitational wave coming from the center of the universe. And I think that's fascinating. And here's a picture of the entire observable universe centered around our galaxy. But here's everything that we're able to observe. And it's really hard to talk about the scale of this. It's really massive for it. Don't quote me on this, but I think the dark spot in the somewhere in the right of the plot is the center of the universe. And there's just been, this is a combination of every instrument and measurement that NASA's ever done in observing what's around us. And this has mostly been done through observing infrared radiation, ultraviolet radiation, optical light. And here's a picture of the observable universe in the microwave frequency range. And so based on the fact that light doesn't do well, any high frequencies don't do well at going through matter. A lot of the light you see here, you can't see behind it, right? A lot of the colors and stuff that you see here, you can't see too far behind it just because of the penetration depth of a lot of electromagnetic radiation. For microwave frequencies, you could see even further, much further, orders of magnitude further than you can using optics and infrared. So through microwaves, we can actually see an order of magnitude deeper back in time than we can with the current instruments. And this is also fascinating because we understand less about what this is saying than what this is saying. And I just think that that's largely because, okay, what I think is really fascinating about electromagnetics is that it's an entire field that was based purely, we came up with a theory behind electromagnetics well before we even had electricity. It was largely mathematically shown and inferred well before it was actually observed. And I wonder to the extent at which we can observe microwave radiation, but we don't understand why it's being generated in the first place. And so there's a lot to understand. There's so much in the next decade. There is so much that NASA and scientists around the world actually are getting together, and they're putting together what's called the through the National Academy of Science, that was called the planetary decadal. And that is where every scientist from every field across over the world gets together, and they figure out what is the most important science questions we need to ask collectively. How do we need to complement each other to answer these questions? And where do these answers lie exactly? So for example, in the last decade, we were very fixated on atmospheres. So a lot of Mars, because we thought life would be on Mars if that's where we wanted.
I'm so sorry to interrupt, because this has been fascinating, but we do need to wrap up and would love to get to questions from the audience members, and have really enjoyed the presentations from our speakers. And I'm sure all of us could listen to this for another hour or two, really. So we'll move on to the Q&A session. And if the two speakers are all right with it, we can always send out an email to everyone that attended tonight with your emails if you have additional questions that you want to pose to the speakers. But we'll clear that with the speakers first. So we'll move into questions. And let's see, the first one was at 7:30 here. We have one from Arshia. They asked, what do you think are the origins of the relationship between atomic vibrations and magnetism? So did we just do that one earlier?
No, I hadn't actually answered this one. Okay. In this case, it turns out that I don't know if I mentioned this during the talk. It was really out of plane atomic vibrations that seemed to be coupled to the magnetic properties. And what we think is that the out-of-plane magnetic interactions are actually being modulated by these vibrations. And you can write down a simple model to show how that would give rise to an effect like this. So it's these vibrations changing the magnetic interactions that makes this happen.
Awesome. Fascinating. Let's see. I know we had another one in the chat as well.
There's another question also in the Q&A. Yeah, and sorry to end your talk, Sushia. It had gone, usually we end the whole thing by 8, but I really like both of your talks. But there is a question for you both in the chat and in the Q&A if you want to answer those live.
So let's see, the one in the chat is, what is the amount of time between pulses in the laser, and does the amount of time between pulses matter?
Oh, that was from earlier.
That's the one we answered earlier.
Okay. The most recent
one. How about this one? Oh, sorry, Angela. All right. Are you aware of any applications of X-ray or gamma radiation for learning more about our universe and or space?
Yeah, I can answer that. It's really hard. That's a regime of frequencies that's really hard in the current state of the art to have a mastery. We're able to, on Earth, use X-rays and gamma rays. Well, obviously use X-rays for medical purposes. But we actually, like, for example, our group has developed a pulsion using X-rays, and it's actually really fascinating. And we're even working on using X-rays for communication. The advantage of X-rays and gamma rays is that they just pierce through anything without even stopping, including DNA. We can take advantage of that to, for example, transmit something through the sun and seeing how that is affected, or we can get extremely high data rates by using X-ray communication to Mars. But in terms of observing X-ray and gamma ray radiation throughout our universe, it's really hard until it hits us to understand anything. And that's a field of science that's actually just recently starting, but it's really interesting.
Okay, we have another question in the Q&A. How would moon craters have to be modified to make them into antennas? What about the moon's surface makes it a favorable place for antennas? Is it strictly the geometry of the craters?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Antennas do need to be shaped a certain way. For example, the best shape for an antenna reflector is a parabolic shape. Naturally, moon craters do follow that geometry surprisingly accurately, and the engineers make up for the differences in that shape through the way a reflector antenna works is that we shoot electromagnetic radiation at the reflector, then the reflector makes it more directional, makes the ripples go exactly in the direction you want. And the reason why the moon is particularly good is not only the shape of the craters, but the material that the craters are made out of semiconductor properties to a degree, in that a characteristic of a semiconductor is that it doesn't fully conduct, but it partially conducts. That is, they affect electromagnetic fields, they affect magnetic fields, but they don't short them out like a normal conductor does. And so if we know how the moon is shaping magnetic fields and shaping electric fields, we can take that. We can take that to our advantage in the design.
Okay. Related to antennas, if I may, I had something to ask you. You talked about how we made these massive antennas to detect gravitational waves. Can you say how they work? I mean, I have an understanding of how electric antennas work, but I just couldn't put it together for something like this.
Yeah, that's a really good question. If the signal, if the wavelength is much bigger than the antenna, then it's not going to effectively transfer that power to your circuit for you to be able to understand what's happening to it. So that's why it needs to be huge. But the reason, so gravitational waves are different because they're not electromagnetic waves, but they are oscillatory. So they have similar geometries. And how we take advantage of that is gravitational waves will affect time and space, right? And so at the beginning when I talked about the whole idea of this field is we know what the signal should do, and then we see what it did do. And in the case of gravitational waves, every electromagnetic waves always moves at the speed of light, no matter what frequency, kilohertz or 100 gigahertz. It all moves at the speed of light in the same medium. And so if you're communicating with Cassini, for example, you know exactly where in the universe Cassini is, you know exactly where you are. So you know, and you know that the signal, you know exactly that the signal is going to travel at the speed of light there and back. So you know how long, you know very precisely how long it's going to take for that signal to go from Cassini and to come back. So if there's any deviation, and I mean like tiny deviation, between what you expect and that time it takes to observe and to what you observed, then that means that you just experience a gravitational wave, because there should be a constant change in time it takes to come back. And whenever there's a change in that, that means you just detected a wave. And you need, and in this case, you need that detector to be solar system wide, because these gravitational waves, the wavelength of these waves are so huge that you wouldn't be able to measure the difference in time if it were short.
Does that matching it to the wavelength of the wave, does that help increase the signal in some way? It's some kind of resonance effect. That's usually what happens with antennas, right?
Yeah. Basically, antennas work like circuits. And so if you're designing an antenna, you need to design the circuit to based on the environment that the signal is going through. So when we design an electromagnetic communication link between here and Pluto, we're using that whole solar system as part of our circuit. And if the signal, if you don't design the antenna to be relative to the size of the wavelength, then there's not gonna be enough current that's going to be induced on the metal of your antenna for it to be able to detect it. Yeah, it's a hard thing to wrap my head.
No, I can imagine. Yeah. I'm gonna look this up too.
Yeah.
Okay, real quick. We have one last question. I just wanna get to it before we close off. And it was, are there microwave sources other than heat sources that we need to consider within observed microwave data coming from the universe?
Yeah, that's what's so fascinating about our microwave instruments, is that actually they can mean anything, because so many things naturally radiate microwave radiation, and not just things, but interactions of multiple things will create things at different signals at different frequencies. And we understand what's happening. We're observing what frequencies are related to what phenomena in our solar system. But the more we study other galaxies, other planets, the more we realize that electromagnetics can be induced by so many more things than just heat. And they can be, in fact, created by just so many things, yeah. And that's what's so fascinating about it.
All right, I think that's all the questions we have in chat, but thank you guys again so much for agreeing to do this. I really enjoyed both of your talks. I wish we had more time to go into this even more, but
really great talks. Thank you so much. And thank you to everyone in the audience that joined tonight. This was our largest Science on Tap event. I think since maybe April 2020. So that is great. Really great to see everyone, you know, virtually. So thank you again to our speakers.
It was a pleasure.
All right. Sign off. Thank you guys.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye everyone.